Trevor was like, family does.
Plus, I sent him the first one of your birthdays on the same day. I can't go out to have some new years.
I know, right?
Yeah, one of yours in there. It was interesting because it's like,
barely.
I don't know, like, Trevor always talked about his morning here in Greg and all the weird stuff that comes with that. And I'm like, I don't know.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. save me.
And I'd like to thank you, family and friends. I'd like to thank everyone to come honor Trevor Francis Bellacomo, my son. And we'd like to begin with a member of Allie, his wife, family reading his obit. And then our family's going to speak, and then we'll open it to some friends who would like to share a memory with Trevor. And I think, is it Emma?
Yes.
Hi, Emma. Let's see, that you would pull it up for me. Well, you know what, while they're pulling that up, let me go ahead and introduce some of our family that's here tonight. Let's see, I first want to acknowledge Allie. With the baseball cap, our cute Allie back there, and her sister Megan, and there's Emma, and I'm sorry, but I can't remember her brother's name.
Ethan.
All right. Are there any other family members here we need to recognize? Oh, your mother. Your mother is, yeah, she's on Zoom from Japan. And so we're so happy that we do have a live Zoom link right now. Unfortunately, those people can't speak, but they can watch. And then there's Sam, Trevor's dad. Is Sam in here? All right. Let's see, there's... Josephine and Marianne. Do you want to raise your hands? His sisters from California and Josephine's husband. There's Sam Bellacomo, and so I'm happy that a lot of our family and friends could fly in and be with us tonight. There are my parents, Mom and Joe. Where's Joe at? Joe? There's my husband, Kevin. Are there any other family members here tonight? But really, you know, our friends are like our family to us as well, because many of you have stood by Trevor for many years when I've known him from Vernal when we lived there, and I have a lot of my friends here that have also been involved with me in women's rights and activism in our state. So my son definitely, we have a long history of this in our family, including Josephine and with animal rights. So I always said in our family, you know, be prepared to go on a march, protest, and have bell money. That's just part of our family. I know when I met my husband, I said, I hope you like marching, because next weekend we're going to the Gay Pride Parade, and that's what we're going to be doing. So, and I thought, you know, if he doesn't make it through that, then he's not meant to be. But if he makes it, then he's in the running. So Trevor was just, you know, so passionate about life. And so we thought we would read the obit if Emma and Ethan have found that. Hi, just come on up and take the microphone. There you go.
Trevor started playing the drums and writing his own music at age 12 when he formed his first band, Destitute Talent, and then the STDs in Vernal, Utah. After moving to Salt Lake City, he played with the 12th Street Staggers, Boot Down Boys, Negative Charge, Never Say Never, NFFU, Revolt, Angry Streets, and many others as a guest drummer across the U.S. He made at least 8 albums with various bands. He also had gigs as a roadie and merchandiser. Trevor always stood out in the crowd with his unique colored hairstyles, tattoos, and self-designed clothes. He had a successful screen printing business, making brand merchandise, patches, punk shirts, and customized studded jackets that sold throughout Europe and Asia. He designed swimwear fabrics and patterns, which were modeled in a punk calendar he created. His clothing and creations were worn by the cast in the cult movie Punk's Dead, Salt Lake City, Punk 2. After the movie, Machine Gun Kelly donated the studded jacket Trevor made to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Trevor lived each waking moment to the fullest. He planned overseas trips each year to attend concerts and visit historical sites such as the pyramids of Egypt. He participated in animal rights protests from Italy to Scotland. He enjoyed the symphony, opera, but especially loved riding roller coasters at Lagoon and visiting Disney parks with his family. Trevor looked like a badass, but was a passionate defender of animal rights. He was fiercely dedicated to leading a vegan lifestyle. He met the love of his life, Allie Goddard, while attending an animal rights protest in California. Together, they traveled cross-country to work as social activists against animal abuse from an AV that Trevor built. They got married in April on Earth Day and were planning to fly to Japan in October for a Japanese marriage ceremony with Allie's family. Trevor had found true happiness with Allie. Trevor provided a voice for the voiceless as he organized and led events with UARC in Salt Lake City. He also volunteered at the Sage Animal Sanctuary on weekends and helped care for each animal there. In lieu of flowers, please consider donations to either Sage Mountain Sanctuary or the Utah Animal Rights Coalition. Trevor is survived by his wife, Allie, mother, Shauna, and spouse, Kevin McGreeny, his father, Salvatore, brother, Bryson, all of Salt Lake City, grandparents, Victoria and Jehinger, grandfather, Jack and Juanita, and aunts, Marianne and Josephine, and spouse, James.
Thank you so much. I just kind of wanted to talk about my son, Trevor, for a moment. You know, he really did burst into this world. He just always had to take center stage no matter what he was doing in life. He was born a few weeks early, and I remember I was going into labor, and I was studying to be a nurse midwife then, and I was a lactation consultant, and I thought, I know how this works, because my first child is my son Bryson. I was several hours, so I thought, this is going to be a while. So I called my midwife and she's like, well, it's probably false labor, just go on over. I probably don't even need to go. Well, by the time I got into the hospital and he was coming. He just literally burst out, could barely even get into a room, lay down, and then I was in the hospital for the next 3 days trying to recover. And because not only did he just burst out, but I sincerely thought I was going to have a girl. And so Sam and I had only picked out names for girls. And Sam is such a huge sports nut because he's from LA. He would fly out to see all the games, Laker games, and just has always loved sports. And so he's like, well, we have to name him Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And I'm like, no. What's the other name we could consider? Magic Johnson. So we spent 3 days in the hospital arguing about what to name him. And we decided to flip a coin. And I said, thank God I won that coin toss. That's how he came to be our Trevor. So with that, you know, Trevor just always really made his own pathway in life. You know, I was telling Allie, even from the time he was a little boy, like 2 years old, he was drawing pictures of himself with spiky hair. And I could never figure out, where did this kid come up with that idea? Because I don't remember seeing anyone with spiky hair back then or where he got that idea. But he was always that way. He always wanted to dress differently, look differently. I think many of you know him from Verla. I spent about every week in the principal's office for his different hair color and hairstyle, and where did he get these clothes? And I just kept thinking, good Lord, can't you people be more concerned with something else besides his hair color or what he's wearing? But that was pretty much Vernal for you. So, you know, he was just such a fun child. I just have Bryson and Trevor, and I was telling some of his other friends, he always loved animals and just had the biggest heart. When he was a little boy, we were renting, and he couldn't have a pet. So he had all of these stuffed animals, and this kid had like probably 100 stuffed animals, and I just had to round them all up in a big net. And he would let them down before he would go to bed at night, and he was just always, my God, he was just so creative. And, you know, I'd go check on him to see if he was asleep, and I'd hear all this noise in there. I'm like, what's going on in there? And he's like, Mom, the animals want to, he would call his, you know, stuffed animal, the animals want to have a party. They want to have a dance party. They won't go to sleep. They just keep talking. And he was just so creative with this all the time. And at one point, I remember my mom gave him this talking bear called Blue Bear. And the boys and I always took a lot of trips together, went everywhere. And this Blue Bear went everywhere that we went. Everywhere we would go, he would set it there. We'd have to take a picture. Blue Bear went here. Blue Bear went to Lagoon. Blue Bear went to Zion's. Blue Bear went to Vegas. Until Blue Bear just smelled so bad, I was ready to. None of us could stand to be around Blue Bear anymore, and I had to switch him out. But Trevor knew it. It was not okay. You know, and that kid was just always wanted to have a lot of animals in the house. And I am allergic to cats, so we could not have a cat. But before we had a dog, one time I remember the babysitter and Bryson in Vernon, we lived in a small town. They came by my office and they had this little red wagon. And in it was like this aquarium, and it was just filled with mice. And I do not like mice or rodents. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what are you people doing? And really, their babysitter said, well, they just wanted to get these and bring them home. I'm like, no mice in the house. That will not be a pet. Later, he did end up getting a hamster and then a rabbit, and we had guinea pigs and fish and a dog. And one point the kids caught, I don't know if it was a badger or a ferret, and brought it in the house that we had to capture and get out. I'm like, yeah, that no wild animals in the house. But you know, he just always cared a lot about other animals. And you know, from an early standpoint, he, like I said, you know, he really did not like eating meat. I couldn't believe it when he was about, I don't know, 6 or 7 years old. He asked if, because I had like after school snacks for them to come home, and he wanted Brussels sprouts. I thought, what kid asked for Brussels sprouts, right? But yeah, Brussels sprouts was like his favorite snack. Or, you know, he wanted, we would grade carrots or potatoes for him under the broiler, but he always was very conscious of not eating meat, didn't want any leather, and I mean, he was a dedicated vegan. He would not wear leather at all, extremely upset if there was any fur around or anything like that. I remember my mother-in-law had come from California, and she had this custom mink coat that she had made that she gave to me to try on. And Trevor's like, you cannot wear that coat anywhere. We cannot have that here. And so I had it, and I was taking it up to Park City. And he said, is that coat in the car? I said, it is. And he literally jumped out of the car because he would not sit in the car with a fur coat. And I just, you know, I'm saying that because he was always very conscious of things like that. And I'm like, I won't wear it. I'm just taking it up to Laura. But he was just so dedicated. I was going to tell a couple funny stories about the boys when our family really likes Disney World. We have a love for Disney because my great-grandmother lived in Florida, and we used to go down there every year for Christmas when I was a little girl, and then we would go to Disney World. So when I had my boys, I'm like, you know, we have to go to Disney World. And I love roller coasters. We all love roller coasters. So we would just ride them over and over again and have so much fun. And one time, I think maybe he was like 13, I remember, you know, he had his punk clothes on. And I saw a shirt that he had on, and it's something about anarchy. I'm like, I don't think that'll be the best shirt to wear at Disney World. I think he should probably wear something else. And I'd also called ahead because with his mohawk, he had to be able to ride Space Mountain, and it was too high. And so he was going to have to take the mohawk down for the day. So he did that, but he didn't have any other clothes to wear. So I told his brother to take him over to the mall and pick out an appropriate shirt. So they come back, and I'm like, well, what shirt do you have to wear? And he opened it up, and it said F. George Bush, who was the president at that time. And I have to say, I really hated George Bush because he's a war criminal, but I'm like, okay, I agree with that philosophy, but that's not the appropriate shirt to wear to Disney World. And I'm like, I said to my son, did I ask you, I put you in charge of this to get an appropriate shirt? Like, that's the only thing we could find, Mom. So, you know, the other thing with clothes is that I just loved it when it came time to buy school clothes for him, because Bryson is kind of like I am, where he wanted brand names, and he just wanted, like, it could be, there was no amount of money that could be enough. But Trevor would say, Mom, give me $20, I'll go to DI, I'll buy some clothes, I'll rip them up, I'll make something, and it'll be great. So he was definitely my frugal child, but he was just so creative, you know. He always liked sewing, making different clothes. He took after my mother, who designed clothes and is a seamstress, and he was just so creative. And it was just a couple of years ago, he asked me, like, for Christmas, he wanted some knitting needles and some yarn to start knitting. And I could not believe how creative he was to come up with all of the things that he made. And, you know, he started making all of these studded jackets, and other people started wanting them, and kind of started a business for himself, and ended up with this screen printing business called Sedition Nightmares, and then ended up making the jacket for Salt Lake Punk 2, which was donated to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with his name on it. And I was always so proud of him and his different look and clothes. And, you know, anywhere he went, people would stop and look. And that's another thing. I remember one time we were in Florida, and we were on our way to Disney, and we were in Miami, and we were walking up and down the strip. I think we were, like, in front of, I want to say, Calvin Klein. And one of the salespeople ran out and saw Trevor, and they're like, who are you? And, you know, asked how long we were going to be in town, and they offered him a modeling job right there on the spot to walk up and down Miami Strip for the next couple of nights and to model their clothes. And he's like, I don't know, he had absolutely no interest. I'm like, Trevor, you could make all of this money. He's like, no, I don't care. But I thought it was really cool that he had that offer, and he really wasn't even interested in it. Another funny thing about one time we were in Florida on our way to Disney World, and I was at this business conference, and we're at this beautiful resort, and the boys decided to leave and go to the beach, and we had gone over there earlier. I'd taken them before this business conference to check things out, and I'm like, well, if you go over to the beach, you'll have to take a taxi. And while we were there, they saw all these people renting scooters and driving them about everywhere, and they're like, oh, this would be so much fun. I'm like, that's not really a good idea, because you have to be, like, over 21. If you rent a scooter under that age, it's going to be, you have to put down a really big deposit. It's like $2,500 for each scooter. And if anything happens, you know, then we're liable for it. So I'm like, just go to the beach, rent a wakeboard, have a fun time. So I went, you know, I was at my meeting and speaking throughout the day, and I went back to the hotel room, and there was no sign of these kids. And I thought, oh my gosh, I wonder what's happened. And this is, I think, really before anyone had a cell phone. And so they come in later that night, and I can immediately tell something horrible has happened. Trevor's all bruised up, his skin is scraped, and Bryson comes in, and he's like, Mom, we rented those scooters. And we're crossing in a crosswalk, and a car hit Trevor, but Trevor had his spiky jacket on and his hair. They're like, you'll never believe it. He literally bounced off of the car because of his hair and his jacket. So he just had some scrapes and cuts, and it was right in front of the fire department. So we can say Being Punk literally saved his life, his jacket and his hair. And, you know, a lot of people who know us remember that, because that was a credit card, you know, $5,000, those deposits and damages, and the next day we were supposed to go to Disney World. And I was so mad at those kids. I'm like, there's no way we're gonna go to Disney World. So I called to cancel it, and they're like, you can't, it's prepaid. So I told the kids, well, I guess the only thing I can do is you don't get any snacks, you can't have any pop or ice cream, you just have to drink milk and water, whatever, you know, and food. So it was just, that's just the way it always worked out. It seems like I could never really punish that kid. the odds were always in his favor. So let me go through my notes here. You know, there were a lot of things in there about the band and when you started music, and there's some people here tonight from Vernal, and I appreciate all of you coming. And remember when Trevor and his friends started that band, those boys were like 12 years old, and they wrote their own music, and they won a contest in Vernal from the radio station. And the radio station came to us parents, and they're like, your kids are really good. We're going to buy them a trailer, take them. They can go on the road, set up some gigs. But, you know, they were all underage, so we had to be with them. And so Trevor was just so dedicated not to play anyone else's music, write all of his own music. And of course, you know, they didn't have a place to practice, so I did the natural thing any parent does. Our family room became the music studio room, and pretty soon I had all these kids hanging out over there all of the time, and then groupies and food, and people would say, what are you doing with all those kids with those crazy clothes on at your house? And I'm like, well, if they're not at my house, where else would they be? So, you know, Trevor always had a lot of friends and people coming over, and lots of girlfriends over the years, and people that wanted to hang out with him. And I was just so proud of everything that he did. And I wanted to point out, I thought, I had no idea when Starks asked us about what Trevor's favorite flower is to be placed with his remains. I said, I don't know. So I asked Allie, and she told me, the bird of paradise. And then I was speaking to his aunt, Josephine, and she said, well, that was my dad's favorite flower, who Trevor is named after, Francis. And then when I talked to Sam about it, he said, well, that's my favorite flower. So I don't know if they all knew that, but I thought, what, that's quite the coincidence. And Josephine said, Shauna, it looks just like Trevor. It looks like a mohawk. I thought, oh my gosh. That kid, just anytime he walked into the room, you know, it was all eyes, and he just lit up the room. He was so much fun, and he will be so missed in our family and loved. So I just wanted to know, is there someone from Allie's family that would like to speak next? You know, I just want to do a shout out to Allie, and I thank her for bringing so much love and light into Trevor's life. He, you know, of course we didn't want our son to go out the way that he did from such a hate-filled act, but he went out the happiest he'd ever been in his entire life. He was very reflective about things that had happened in the past, or mistakes that had been made, or past, you know, relationships. And he and Allie were really soulmates, and has spent the past year on the road with animal rights and activism, and I'm just so happy that they were able to find each other and make each other so happy if he had to be taken from us, and want to thank Allie for being there and just loving Trevor completely. And if you'd like to say anything else, brothers, sisters, if not, I'll ask Sam, Josephine, Marianne.
I just wanted to thank all of you for coming tonight and paying this tribute to Trevor. It means a lot to me. And also a special thank you. I was just informed about half an hour ago that much of this tonight was provided by an anonymous donor. So I have no idea who this person or persons are, but I appreciate it, and I'll always be in debt to you. Thanks again for coming.
Thank you, everyone, for coming. There are no words, and then the words find their way through. So when Trevor was born, this is about a year and a half after my father had died, and there seems to be nothing that can so be a balm for grief than to have life. And it was so wonderful, as Shauna said, he was named his middle name, was after my father. So, you know, Trevor is a he's a second generation American. He really wanted to go back to Sicily and go visit where my mother and my father were from. He was never able to make that trip. But he's also the first generation of Bella Comos who understand the concept of an inside voice. You all understand the concept of his outside voice. You've been seeing it all around you. But that's the point of it, is that he was so sensitive to being a voice for the voiceless and being witness to the suffering of the animals and having the courage to speak out. And he would tell me about doing protests with Cube of Truth, where they're mostly silent. And if you see the picture of Trevor where he's wearing a mask, that's Cube of Truth. You know, they show the video, undercover video. And then if people want to approach someone, then they can talk to him. And I was stunned to learn, like, people actually approach you and they talk to you. And he was so articulate, that inside voice, being so clear, so driven to want to advocate for the animals and to solve for injustice. So that was a path that I shared with him, and I was always so proud of him when he texted me those pictures of him at the rodeo, and he'd organized these protests and spoke out so powerfully. So we say, you know, rest in peace, and with Trevor, rest in power.
Hello, everyone. I'm Trevor's grandma, and this is my grandpa's right there. You can come up here, honey. There are, want to thank all of you for coming. Thank my daughter for all the tireless effort that she's put into this, and thank her for giving me my two grandchildren, whom I love very much. Each one of them is different in their own right, with their own goals, their own expectations, and their own love of each other, for they truly were brothers and loved each other. Took a while to get there when they were little, but you know how that is. You fight with your siblings as you're growing up. And we have so many stories. I used to go out and stay with the kids when Shauna went to political events. And I would ride on a freighter before I had flight privileges as a flight attendant. And they'd pick me up in Salt Lake and then later on in Vernal. And I'd come over while their mother went to some political organization or on a vacation later. And we had a lot of adventures, the boys and I, back then. And during, Shauna mentioned about the hair, and I remember, actually, I'm the first one to dye his hair. And she was gone, I think it was D.C., and Trevor came to me and he said, Grandma, I want to dye my hair with Kool-Aid. And I said, well, honey, I think you better wait till your mom comes home because I don't know what the rules are at school and she might not like it. Well, if you don't help me, Grandma, I'm going to do it my own self. So what's a grandma to do? Oh, pick those up for me, honey. Sorry. Anyway, I dyed his hair, and that was his first hair job. It was yellow. And yellow and orange were his favorite colors for such a long time. And then we were talking about, I told my husband, I taught Trevor how to drive, and how to drive a straight stick. And he said, yeah, you did that. You taught him how to drive here in Indianapolis. I said, no, it was Salt Lake. And then I remembered when he was 12, he wanted to learn to drive. So we went to the church parking lot, and I taught him how to drive an automatic. And then later, when he became 16, when Shauna lived in an apartment, there was this huge park across the street and a parking lot, and that's where I taught him how to drive a straight stick. And then his band started. He started his band in high school. I don't remember the name of it. But I was flying out here, and back in the day, I had to wear a suit to travel with my air carrier. And he had given me, this was before cell phones and et cetera, and he'd given me exact directions as how to go, because he always knew exactly how to go, and he'd write it out for me. And I came to this cul-de-sac, and he was playing for one of his friends at a birthday party, and they were getting paid for this gig. So I saw a bunch of cars, and then I saw a couple of kids out here with Mohawks going into this house, so I knew that had to be the place. Walked in, and there were no adults there, and I thought that was very strange, but I didn't really know what to expect, so I went towards the music, and there was they were in the basement, and I started walking down the stairs, and there were some kids on the steps, and when I got to the bottom, kid says, "Hey, are you Trevor's grandma?" And I said, "Yes." And then they yelled out, "Trevor, your grandma's here." So Trevor quits playing the drums. He gets up. "Hey, kids, give a shout out to my grandma." And he gets up, and I'll bet you I'll never heard him sing. He got up, and he sang to me, and he ripped his shirt off. I was like, "Oh, my gosh, this kid's a star already." And then he used to come and visit us every year. And he would just want to come and reorient himself. And when he dropped out of high school, he said he needed to get his head on straight, and he wanted to come and stay. And I said, "Well, of course, honey, you know you're welcome to come and stay anytime, but I want you to make me a promise. I want you to promise to get your GED while you're here." He said, "Okay, Grandma." So I got all the information, was ready when he got there. And he says, "You know, I can pass this without taking any extra courses." And so he tried, and he said, "The only thing I might need help in is English." And that was it. So he took the English course, and then he just aced everything. And he was offered a two-year scholarship in Tennessee. But as my daughter told you, he wasn't interested in any of that because that wasn't the path that he wanted to follow. And then the next time that he came and lived with us, he wanted to learn to sew. He'd been making all of these clothes and with, Tony would tell us, with fishing line. And anyway, he wanted to learn to sew, so he came to stay with me, and he started off with bathing suits. And he perfected it, and he was making his own patterns, and once I got him started, away he went like a flash. He worked when he came, also had a job, and he would show up early, win every award that there was, and extra money, and he'd stay late, and he couldn't understand why people weren't dedicated to any job that they have, why they would be late, why they would quit. And during that time, Grandpa here was working on getting his master's degree. So back and forth, when we drove Trevor to work, he would tell him about business and business plans. Do you want to add any of that, honey?
Yeah, so I said to Trevor one day, I said, "Trevor, why don't you take that scholarship, and I'll keep your job, and you can go to school." And he goes, "Grandpa, that sounds very stressful to do." And I said, "What did you just say?" He goes, "I think it's very stressful." And I said, "So I pick you up every morning, I take you to work, then I go to work, then I get off work, I pick you up, and then I take you home, and then I go to school, and then I come back home, and how old are you?" And he just looked at me, started laughing, and we both started laughing at it. He was a character, you know? And I remember the time he came over, and he goes, "Grandpa, I need a job. I want to have money because I want to buy a van for the band." I don't remember which band most of you guys probably know, but he was getting a van for his band. And so we made a plan how we were going to earn that money, got him a job, first paycheck. He takes half of that paycheck and goes, "I want to get a tattoo." I said, "That is not part of the plan, I do not approve of a tattoo. You got enough. And
it was never enough.
We'll talk about it later. And then Grandma comes over to me and she goes, you know, if you don't help him get a tattoo, he'll go someplace and it could be an unsanitary place and he's going to do it anyway. Grandma's always right. And so I went to Trevor and said, okay, if you still want a tattoo, I will take you to a shop, but I will inspect the shop first. And if it meets my health requirements, you can get your tattoo. Otherwise, we're leaving. And so I went there, inspected it, checked it out, and it was clean. There weren't going to be any infections or anything from the needles. So I said, okay, you can get a tattoo. And then he goes, which one should I get? I looked at all of them. I said, none of them. But he was determined. So I said, go ahead, pick whichever one you want then. And he did. And he got his tattoo, you know? But my fondest memories of Trevor and Bryson is Trevor was 2. Bryson was, I think, 3.5, 4 at that time. And these guys would come over, and we would babysit them in Indianapolis. And after dinner, they had so much energy. You know, we could just bottle that. We'd be millionaires by now, you know? Both of those kids. And we would just wrestle on the floor, try to burn up some of their energy, and I would burn out before they did. And then they would fall asleep on the couch watching TV, and then I would take each one of them upstairs into that room, and that room was unusual because it was made for their mother that grandma made a wall that was blue with giant rainbow and stars. And so okay.
Yeah, I painted it.
Grandma painted it. And so they slept in the same room as their mother when she was a kid. And I would put them down, and I put Trevor down, and I'd cover them up with their blanket. And those were the fondest memories for me of Trevor, you know? And the other thing I would share is that Trevor, most of you guys knew Trevor as a great drummer, and he was awesome. Because I took him to a place in Tennessee where there was a concert, and there was this big time producer down there from Nashville, and he said, hey, this 16-year-old kid of yours telling us is awesome. I would love to take him to Nashville, and I can get him session gigs with some of the top artists down there. And I said, Trevor, would you like to do that? And he goes, no, I'm punk. I'm not country. I'm not doing all of that. And I said, but this one pays. He says, no, I'm not selling out, you know? So he was an unusual kid. But he was talented, and most of you guys knew him as a fashion
designer,
artist. But, you know, I knew him as my grandson, Trevor Bellacomo, you know. And I'm well pleased in my grandson on how he turned out, you know. And our last memories was with him and Allie, because we hadn't met Allie before we came here. And we got to have breakfast with him on that day, with him and Allie. Took pictures with them. Some of them are up there. It was the most awesome time. We saw, and we actually talked about it after we left breakfast. And Grandma said, doesn't his voice sound different? Isn't he sound so peaceful and happy and in love? And I said, yeah, he does, you know. And we heard their plans for their future. It was really an awesome moment. And we're so blessed that we got to have that moment with him at that time.
I want to say just a couple more things. Trevor, two of his favorite things in life at that time was his dog Eleanor and his grandma. And he showed up one trip, and he had Eleanor tattooed on his arm and Grandma, only Victoria, tattooed underneath it. And then he also did a drawing, and I had Eleanor and Victoria, and that's framed. That's always up in my home. And I used to say, well, there were times when I was sick, and I said, you know, I don't know what in the world I would do or where I would go and live if something happened to Grandpa. And he'd say, Grandma, I got you. Don't you worry. I'll be there for you. And I said, honey, you'll have a family. You've got your job. you can't come and live with me. He said, I will always be there for you. If you can't go up and down the steps, I'll carry you. Don't you worry, we'll work it out. And that's the way he always was. He always kept in contact with us his entire life. Everywhere he went, he told us before he was going, when he got there, what he was doing, and sent us pictures afterwards. And we always ended with, love you, see you. He'd say, I love you, Grandma. I'll see you soon. And then we'd say goodbye. And that's just the way it is now. I love you, Trevor. I'll see you soon. Goodbye. Bryson?
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? My name's Bryson. I'm Trevor's brother. Trevor meant everything to me. You all knew him, and there was no one like him. Trevor was a force, and he was larger than life. You know, so much of my own life and the things I've done, I would have never been able to do without my brother. Because I saw how unapologetically he was his authentic self. And he didn't ask for permission to be himself. And I think we all have so much we can learn from him. I have so much respect for my brother. I think his legacy will certainly live on in all of us whenever we do what we know is right and we try to give a voice to those that don't have a voice. You know, even when we were kids, I just was so impressed with everything he could do. He could do more in an hour than I could do in a day. And yeah, we fought when we were kids, but you know, we'd like punch each other in the face and then play Sonic together. He was good at everything he did. It was so annoying sometimes. Like, anything he did, he was awesome at it. But it really was just him refusing to believe in the lie and to go along with what we're told to do that was so impressive to me. And I think sometimes Trevor's inability to play by the rules is what has allowed me to play by the rules in life. Because I knew that he was like balancing me out. And I was always so in awe of his creativity. It just like had to come out. Like when we were kids, we were moving from our house. He was like 9. We were moving from our apartment to a house we were renting, and we moved the beds. We found that he had carved the word shack into the wall because he like loved Shaquille O'Neal. And he just did stuff like that all the time. And I just don't know how he was so creative. Like, one time when he and I both were getting into punk at the same time, he really liked MXPX, and he's like, bro, come check out what I did. And so I go into his room, And I guess because he didn't have anything else, like, he had taken a bunch of packaging tape and drew, like, the MXPX head, like, on the carpet, just in his whole room. And I was like, cool, dude, why? Like, he just, like, had to do something, you know? He was so creative. And I think he also understood people in a way that I think I still don't. When we were in Florida one time, I think I was, like, maybe 16, Trevor was, like, 13, 14, and he had his mohawk then, and he got so much attention from it, and, like, people would come up, be like, hey, can we take a picture with you, and everywhere we went, and it was so funny, because people would come up and say, like, you know, can we get a picture, and he'd be like, yeah, if you give me a dollar, and for me, I was, like, over to the side, just, like, dying, like, just let them take a picture, you know? But then, like, I realized, you know, then I'd see that these people got more hyped about it when he was like, yeah, give me a dollar. And I think that was something I just never, like, Trevor understood people in ways I didn't and still don't, you know? Like, I still couldn't do that. But he knew it was going to hype them up. And I'm just so grateful. So grateful for my brother. I'm grateful for Allie. Allie made him so happy. I was on rotation at the VA hospital just a couple weeks ago, and I got done and got in my car, and I got a call from my brother. It's like, hey, brother, what are you up to? I was like, we called each other brother. I don't know why. He started doing it a long time ago. And, you know, like, hey, brother, what's up? What are you doing? I was like, nothing. Just, you know, got done with, like, work and stuff. What are you up to? And he's like, not much. Hey, do you think you could come and marry me and Allie tomorrow? It's like, sure. Of course. Why not? You know? He's like, yeah, it's Earth Day, and we'd really like for you to do it. And I started crying. I was just so flattered that he would ask me. I just appreciated Trevor including me in his life at any time. I love him so much. And I'm just so lucky. To have him as my brother. I don't think I could have ever met someone like him without him. And I'm really grateful for all of you to be here. His friends and his community meant so much to him. And it really means so much to see all of you here. Just to know that you knew his heart. His heart was so big, it's so much bigger than mine. And he opened his heart to people that I think I would never have otherwise. And he was such an inspiration to me. If anyone has anything they'd like to say about my brother, you're more than welcome to come up.
Thank you, son. You know, I just wanted to mention, yeah, Trevor was so eclectic and had so many different interests and varies. Tonight, our pianist has been playing part of Beethoven's Symphony No. 9 because he loved going to the symphony. His favorite movie was Clockwork Orange. He loved that music, and that's why our pianist is playing that. And so he and his friend Billy Tony, childhood friend, I would give them tickets to the symphony or opera on his birthday, because Billy Tony shares the same birthday, to go listen to that music. And I don't think a lot of people realize, you know, Trevor also had this taste for the symphony and the opera. And when it comes to the business and even taking his picture and asking for a dollar, he loved to watch Shark Tank and all of these business shows. It was making business plans all of the time. And, you know, he had made up, you know, the punk rock calendar and cards, and just done so many different things and patches, and was selling shirts and God, he had some shirts that sold like in New York for $400 and clothes over in, you know, Asia, and had a huge following. And then, you know, just as he was dedicated to some of the true form of music and punk rock, he felt the same way about animal rights. And I just wanted to ask Billy, Tony, would you like to say anything? Because we had talked before and you said you might, but it's okay even if you're not up to it, dear.
You're right.
All right. I'm Billy Tony. A lot of you probably know me. I'm not really sure exactly what to say, you know, but I guess I did have something in mind, just something that, I don't know, like Trevor, you know, he was a lot of things, and I feel like a lot of people, they think of, I don't know, just how he was industrious, a tailor, or an activist, you know, or all these other things, and that's wonderful, it really is, like, you know, but for me first, he was my friend, you know, it's hard to put a measure on the value of somebody's character, and there are many ways people can pass judgment on that, but I have always been a fan of candid, you know, what people do when you don't think they're watching. And for me, like, Trevor and I had already been friends for several years at this time, and remember it was a rainy day, and I was just being really annoying, and I could tell. I was kind of playing on it, just bugging people. I don't know, getting a laugh out of it. And we were somewhere, and we rode back in a few different cars to his girlfriend's house at the time, and the car I rode in got there first. And I thought it'd be funny to mess with Trevor and be like, dude, you guys should just tell him that you ditched me on the side of the road, you know? And, you know, when he actually got there and they said that, you know, like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know, I wasn't really sure what to expect. But, like, you know, Trevor stood up for me, and he was really upset, and he actually wanted to go back and pick me up and asked where they left me at. And, you know, like, I put a lot of value into things like loyalty. I'm somebody who, I put a lot of stock into my own personal code of conduct and my morals. And, you know, Trevor displayed to me in that moment, and in many, many times after that, you know, just how loyal he was, you know. And the thing is that's not for free. That's not cheap. You can't buy that. You can't find it under a rock, you know. So for me, it's just like, that's probably one of the things I'll always reflect on, because it's very easy to be complacent, you know, whenever you're under peer pressure or care what other people might think. But to, you know, I don't know, really not care about that at all and care more about, you know, what actually matters to you, like something like friendship or, you know, just that concern, that's priceless. And I'll never forget it. It'll be with me for the rest of my life. And honestly, I hope that, I hope it's those hidden qualities people remember him most for, because it's easy to overlook just, you know, those things with somebody who had so much. I mean, Trevor was accomplished at so much. I mean, he like traveled the world. I mean, he did it all, you know, but, you know, he had values and he had solid family values. And, as a family man myself, I respect the hell out of him for it. Honestly, I could probably stand up here all night just talking, because, you know, like, I really do have a lifetime worth of stories I could tell. But I'm sure so do a lot of other people. So I don't know who would want to speak next. But.
Thank you, Billy Tony. Thank you for being such a good friend. And the two of them had started a business together. And he's right. I just want to emphasize, some of these pictures are just Trevor making plans to go over to Europe and then be involved in animal rights groups and, you know, to visit places like Egypt and Italy and Scotland and go to shows and concerts, and he would make these plans and work and take over merchandise and sell it. And I'm just so glad that he lived his life the way that he wanted to, and got to travel and see and be with people that he wanted. And it looks like Allie, do you want me to bring this over to you, hon?
I don't know most of you. I only got to have Trevor for a year. We were married for 2 weeks. I've never met anyone who like just checked all the boxes. Super passionate vegan, super punk rock and fun, world traveler, like everything I wanted in somebody. And he took such good care of me, oh my gosh. He was kind. And I assume that if you're here, it's because you cared about him too. So thank you for being the type of people who care. And thank you so much to our activist community. I hope you guys stay strong. He was definitely like the most powerful organizer, and he brought all of us together nonstop. Like he was unstoppable. And he loved the animals. And other than keeping punk rock alive all over the world, it was animal liberation was his number one thing. I love you, Trevor. And stop following me into the bathrooms. I'm serious. Visit your grandma, and just stay with us, and know that we'll be okay because you inspired us, you empowered us, you uplifted us. That's what just you were so good at that. Thank you again for being here. Okay.
And yes, thanks everyone for coming. And like Sam said earlier, we did have a generous friend pay for tonight's services, and we want to thank him, who wants to remain anonymous to us as well. And we're just so blessed to have so many good family and friends here. Many people I've known for many, many years since the boys were born, and my friend Kara and her husband that came. I mean, we're all pregnant together with these kids at the same time. And she told me, I remember his cute little curls on his head. And we're just so happy that you could be here and celebrate his life and honor him. We want to thank Starks for making all vegan food, only serving vegan food tonight. And thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.